thinking about when I graduated in high school from Lakewood High, and I thought, no, I'm going to tell you what that
was. Oh, I see. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, now I understand the dramatic pause.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right, I'm ready. You ready?
Yeah.
Here we go. 3, 2, here we go.
Yo, welcome to the Bub and Bob Show, where we talk about faith, culture, and all kinds of other things from a Christian worldview. I'm Bub Coons, and over there somewhere in the dark is Bob Matossian.
How you doing, Bob?
You know, I'm doing good. Anything to say, or...
You know, I think you better be on your best behavior today.
Oh, I should be.
Yes, we have a very special guest.
So I'll get right into it.
All right.
Our guest today is the CEO and founder of the Obrier Group. She is a leader and a pioneer when it comes to women's care, and she is a warrior on the front lines of the pro-life battle. She's been fighting hard for over 35 years. This is the dauntless and dedicated Kathleen Eaton Bravo. Hi.
Welcome.
Welcome to the Bub and Bob Show.
I'm so glad to be here.
So glad that you can join us. What we like to do at the beginning is to kind of get the lay of the land and figure out who you were before you came to faith in God. What was it like being, you know, raised by your family? And then what happened when we get into your testimony? Then we're going to switch into what you're passionate about, which we both know what that is. It's Obrier and what you're doing. But
yes.
We got all kinds of time. We're not in a hurry, but tell me how you grew up.
Born and raised in just outside Seattle to Patrick and Patricia O'Brien, Irish Catholic family, six kids. I have three older brothers and two younger sisters. At 13 years old, my father's gambling had totally taken control of his life.
Wow.
And so the beautiful home that they had built was gone. He embezzled money from the company he worked for, was running. He was a smart man, but really...
smart embezzler.
Yes, yeah. But it was, you know, the sort of in my, you know, my culture, the Irish culture is he lived up to his name. Patrick O'Brien was a gambler,
like
knew every pony, was at the track. In fact, as little kids, mom thought that if dad took all the kids... on a Saturday, that he wouldn't go to the racetrack. And let me tell you, we knew everything about the racetrack.
Yeah.
Three boys and me, and dad would go inside and we'd climb on top of the cars and watch the horses go by. And needless to say, I've never been to a racetrack since I grew up.
It seemed like it wasn't fun at the time.
Well, it was fun with your brothers. And then we were behind, you know, a couple of the bars, his favorite hideout. So they, same thing. Mom thought, well, you know, he's got the kids, so he's not going to do anything. Well, you know, we just played an alley. You know, you did kick the can and
nothing's going to stop him,
nothing.
Apparently.
So we grew up in, I grew up in the alleys behind the bars and the racetrack, you know, Long Acres up there. It's not there anymore. And life was pretty much that type of a life.
Yeah.
We grew up, we took care of ourselves. They had two more girls after me, so six of us. And then one day, I remember it was a Sunday and... we were at the park and I saw my mom and dad sitting at one of the picnic tables on the bench far, you know, ways off. And my brothers were running around and mom was crying. Now you have to understand my mother never raised her voice, never argued, never fought. She was very meek. In many ways, as I got older, I resented that. And we had a really bad relationship because I wanted her to fight. I guess because I'm a warrior, maybe that's where it comes from. But I knew something was going on. What it was he was caught embezzling money from his company and that he was running this other man's company. And
is that was to support his habits and gambling?
Of course. He took money out of the company and more money and more money. And the owner of the company found it and he was let go. And he unbelievably didn't send him to jail, but told him to get out of the state of Washington. So we moved to California and that was sort of my...
Growing up, he got out of town.
Yes.
Wow.
And so we ended up in Lakewood, California.
Okay. Yeah. So, so I'm guessing Christmas and Easter when you went to church, or was you got to go to mass or nothing?
Oh,
or
no,
was
no,
it
no.
Every
My
Sunday?
Mother marched us into church every Sunday.
Okay. So you all were repenting for your dad's.
We were. And he was there.
Yeah. He was there.
Oh, yes. They were. So she just accepted that this was her life.
Okay.
And, but as we grew older, so we moved from this beautiful home in Seattle that they had built to, I think, 1,000 square foot the typical Lakewood little box house, you know, with three bedrooms. With your mom and dad, six kids, and then a cousin moved in, Jerry, and so then there was seven of us, and then grandma moved in, so there was so
that
it was
crazy.
I mean, six, seven, eight, nine of us. So anyway, there was 10 of us. And you know, I had a washing machine but no dryer, so hanging the clothes out on the line. And
couldn't even imagine that anymore. We're just
and
so spoiled.
So, but every Sunday we went to church. As we grew older, mom decided to go. We were Catholic. She'd go to the 7 a.m. Mass. Okay. But we always went. And so she would tell dad, you know, well, you've got to take the kids to the 10 o'clock.
Yeah.
And dad would drop us off at the church and we'd go in. And he said, now listen to the homily and let me know who's saying the Mass.
So he can answer sometime during the week.
So he did. And get the bulletin.
Yes.
So we would go in to Mass, and then at the end of Mass, he'd pick us up. We'd hand him the bulletin. Who said the Mass? What was the homily? And we'd tell him, and he'd go home. And he'd tell mom, you know, here's the thing. Father so-and-so said this. At that time in my life, we were, you know, I was getting my clothes from the clothing shop at the church, and our groceries were coming from the church pantry, and we had nothing. We rented this little house that was cardboard on a lot of the windows. And and so needless to say, I just ran. Yeah. So at 15, I moved in with a friend whose parents were just as crazy.
Yes.
And then at 17, just before my 17th birthday, I rented my first apartment and never looked back.
Fantastic.
And I walked away from my faith. Any faith in God.
Well, I don't know if it was a firm foundation that was there when you had the model of your dad. But I mean, did anything take? Like when you were there, did you acknowledge that there was a God and that, you know, Christ is real? Or was it just like, nothing? Just it was just time to sit and be quiet.
We went to Catholic school up till eighth grade. And then I went 2 years after actually high school to an all-girls Catholic school. Met my best friends there, but there was nothing in, you know, I don't even remember it. I don't remember it. So obviously there was just nothing that I could go back and know when, you know, I would be praying or, you know, maybe. My mother was the devout Irish Catholic mom. And I mean, even in the evenings, we would all come together and kneel and pray the rosary in the evening.
Wow.
But I remember... but I had a very angry, I was a very angry young woman when I finally left, against my father for being who he was and drunk and gambling.
He was in the house
and my mother, I was more angry at her that she didn't fight.
Wow. What about your other siblings? Were they just okay with everything? Were you the fighter?
I was the fighter. Okay. Sadly, people that know my family look at me and say, how did you ever raise yourself up out of that family? They actually say that. I mean, people that have known my family even to this day.
Sure.
And so you can imagine how I shifted my life into, first and foremost, I felt like I was Scarlett O'Hara, you know, and Gone with the Wind, and she pulled the carrot out when she finally got Tara back, you know, and she held it up and said, as God is my witness, I will never go hungry again. And mine was, as God is my witness, I will never be poor again.
Okay.
And I just, you know, was going to college, got a job with Pac Bell and became AT&T, started moving up the corporate ladder, got through 3 years of college and left that. I was actually... You'll enjoy this.
Yeah.
So, you know, back in those days, this shows you how old I am.
Those days,
Yeah,
that era.
So AT&T, you know, that's when the EEOC or, you know, women have to go out and do the non-traditional job. So I'm in the corporate offices in Southern California here. And my boss came to me, a general manager, and says, we'd like you to go out and run a splicing crew. You know, it's never heard of for women. And I looked at him and I said, what are you, nuts? You know? And I said, why me? And he goes, we just think that you have the tenacity and the, what? I said, what? Pain in the you-know-what attitude? And I said, well, if you pay me what you're paying those foremen out there, I'm going to do it. I said, what do I have to do? He goes, well, you have to climb a 40-foot and a 50-foot pole, you know, with gaps in your, you know, in your leg, and you know, and women's bodies really aren't made to climb.
So, Kathleen, I was a TSP when they were moving men inside and women outside.
Yes,
I became a TSPS operator.
Seriously,
yes, I did.
What is that?
She knows what it is.
Well, I don't know what it is. So you didn't climb the poles and she was.
Exactly. Okay. They wanted the girls
to... So the big switch, they were trying out equality for all. I get it. But you fought for the wages.
I did.
Which I thought was great. Did you get it?
Oh, yeah, I did. I climbed those poles and I went down manholes. I hate spiders. And I went down manholes and mucked manholes and spliced cable. And then I had my first crew. And then one crew ended up being six crews. And then I moved up the corporate ladder and ended up in their corporate offices in San Francisco. And I never looked back. I realized that this was, you know, I was... So basically my dream, I had a beautiful home.
Yeah.
I had a one-year-old child, a little boy, Christopher. I had a beautiful home and the marriage fell apart.
Mm.
And so I sold the house, took Christopher, the two of us were together, and pretty much my life went down there. So I met a man.
Okay.
He made me laugh.
After the marriage
Marriage. Okay. We weren't officially divorced,
so
but I'm alone.
Yeah.
And he went back to his parents, and by this time, I'm in my mid-20s, and... So I just took my son and I just changed my lifestyle. And basically, I didn't have God in my life.
Right.
And so at that point, I had the BMW and had my condo and my son was in daycare and I had the nice clothes. And I just thought I was on top of the world. This was my dream. And at 28 years old, I found myself in an unplanned pregnancy. Mm. And my son was 3 years old. And so... I just never thought about it.
Yeah.
And back then, to show you how old I am again, you know, you go to the yellow pages to look, and the only thing there was Planned Parenthood. So I was actually out on a job one day, checking up on a couple crews and a big job, and was in my, you know, company car, and across the street was Planned Parenthood. And so I went in, and they showed me these two little PowerPoints of a uterus and said, oh, it's just going to be heavy bleeding and blah, blah, blah. So they couldn't schedule me that day and they were going to schedule me the next day. And I left. And then the next day I ended up at a Family Planning Associates. It was closer to my office and they are the for-profit abortion here in California.
Right.
And I walked in the front door and walked out the back door. It was horrible. I had no meds because I drove myself there. So it was 15 to 20 minutes of screaming pain. And I was screaming. I remember the only thing the doctor said was to the nurse, pinch her leg so she'll quit screaming. So she'll concentrate on that pain. And it sort of worked, but didn't work.
Sure.
And I was moved into the back room and literally was mattresses on the floor. I laid there.
This is when lots of women died then.
A lot of women died then. And this man was just a butcher.
Yeah.
And then...
So what kind of... Did they ask questions? Did they do... Did
nothing.
They just say, no, pay for it? And
nothing at all. They never said a word to me.
They
didn't care
who you were,
no.
or the baby, or anything. Didn't try to...
Nothing.
Just money.
Yes.
Money exchange.
Cash.
Of course.
Yeah. And they gave me a pill. Yeah. It was a Tylenol 3. So, I mean, it did nothing. And I sat... I remember sitting in the room, and there was about 8 exam rooms, and I saw the doctor going back and forth, and I was just numb. I can remember him. I can remember what he said. I can remember the room. I can remember where they walked me to in the back, in the mattresses, and the girls all around me crying. Many of them much younger. That time I was 28 years old. I was 28 years old. I had a child. I knew better.
Yeah.
But yet, when I reached out a hand, the only person that was there when I walked into that Planned Parenthood and realized, well, I can do this. I can have an abortion. I can't have this child.
Yeah.
And even though I didn't have the abortion at Planned Parenthood, it was actually worse.
Yeah.
I don't know. It doesn't matter, worse or not. I ended up at a Family Plan Associates. Yeah. So
the pressure, the pressure of the world and your dreams,
yes.
you didn't want to give it up. And then,
could you imagine running construction crews at that age with AT&T being pregnant? I would have lost my job most likely.
Yeah, fear kicks in and no one's going to help. And
that's poverty looked like that's going to be me. 2 children, no job.
Yeah.
No, I'm not going down. Been
but
down there.
That's where tons of people are now.
Yes.
I mean, still, it's really no different, and no one's helping out, and people even as clinically as sanitary as they want to call it, the people are still dying from abortions.
Oh my gosh, still.
I mean, not to mention the child, obviously, who's
Yeah. Especially dying. Nowadays. I mean, we could talk about it later, but, you know, in 22 states now, they followed, 19 states, yeah, they have followed New York's law of aborting the baby up to the baby is delivered. And then if the baby, that little stinker, survives that abortion, well, the mother's already chosen. So we're just going to put it in a closet and let it die, or give it an injection and stop the baby's heart. So we are now a nation that has embraced infanticide. And so for me, you know, remember there was no God in my life. So I had nowhere to turn except to withdraw inside myself.
And they still try to normalize it though.
Oh my gosh.
That's the issue with it. It's like, it's not really a kid. It's a fetus. They're using every word.
Every word.
Every trick that they can, instead of just being honest with you and saying, we can help you. And this could be an amazing pregnancy and you can put it up for adoption and the world could go on. But it's,
there's this feeling that they didn't want to give you that warm, fuzzy feeling. I think it was, they must think that because if they're very sterile and, you know, and there's no warmth, that you're just going to go through this process and you're going to go out the back door.
This is like stitches if you
and
get
go
a
back
cut,
to normal.
Thanks a lot. See you.
Yes. Yeah. But I went out the back door. And I say, God has a sense of humor. I had a flat tire on my truck, on my car.
When you got out, it was flat.
Yes, it was flat. And so I was in extreme pain and I sat on the curb and I, you know, called AAA and come, I have a flat. And so while I was waiting, it was those 20 minutes that changed my life.
Wow.
Now, well, I basically just started, the pain was so bad. And then I realized it wasn't just the pain in my body. It was the pain in my heart and my mind, my soul. It was just like, I was just like rocking back and forth. And I sobbing actually turned into almost wailing. Like, what have I done? And I kept thinking of Christopher and how beautiful he is. And so anyway, that's where I said to God, you know, they say that you never turn your back on us. I have a hard time to believe that. I don't know you. Mm-hmm. I've had a horrible life. It was just that moment of saying, so here I am, you know, sort of saying, do you still love me? Yeah. And where do I go from here? And
His grace.
Bob, it was, there he was. And when I was rocking, he was rocking me. Yeah. And it was that moment I realized, oh my God, what have I done? Who am I? How did I get here? You know, there was a lot of other things that happened in that home that I lived in and grew up in that I faced finally in the reality of why I was numb. Mm-hmm. And so I just said that the tow truck came, I got in the car, I didn't go back to the office, I went home and thought about what happened on the curb. But I didn't then stand up and go down a different path.
Right.
I actually went down a slippery slope where I almost lost custody of my son. I walked away from that job. I sold the house. The BMW was gone. I didn't care. I met a man and he had a place out at the Colorado River and he was a lot of fun and I had money saved and I didn't really care about what the future was. And so he said, let's get married. And I said, okay. And we did. And then he quit his job and we just hit the road and he was from Oklahoma. So we moved to Oklahoma City and we moved in on Halloween. And that night I sat with my feet in the sink and looking down the road out the window and I knew I was going to end my life.
Oh, wow. And so you were running all that time.
You
were running like crazy.
And it was almost a year that I had been running with this man and now married to a man I didn't know or love. And I'm in Oklahoma City and it was the end of the road for me. And I realized when the sun started rising that I could take those pills or I could go to church. And by the grace of God, I went to church.
Wow.
And amazingly, oh my gosh, in this little church that was 3 miles away And at the end of the service, a woman, you know, the pastor said, you know, everybody sit down. Oh, I have to tell you, being in that church, I wanted to claw my eyes out. I felt like I was so under attack. I was being screamed at in every part of my body to run. I was like, I couldn't get out fast enough. I was, and I, snot nose sobbing.
Well, the force of conviction right in front of you.
Right in front of me.
The truth just finally hits. But God drew you there and you didn't run out.
I didn't run because at the end of that, when the pastor got up and said, sit down, I'm going, oh my gosh,
that's the last thing I want to hear.
And so I sat down thinking I'm going to climb over the pews, you know, I'm going to get out of here. And this woman gets up and she doesn't mind if I use her name, but Barbara Chisco. And she said, I run a, you know, I run a pregnancy center and we reach out our hand and we help women that are facing an unplanned pregnancy. And on that curb behind that abortion clinic, is exactly what I said. God, bring me one woman. If I can change her mind, I forgive myself. That was the words on the curb behind that Family Planning Associates. And a year later, that is the exact words that was spoken to me from God at that church.
And then answered with this woman.
And I walked up to her and I said, I think I want to help. And that was the beginning of my 38 years in this movement. And I immediately started volunteering. I brought that model back to Southern California, took over a pregnancy center, opened up two more, took them medical because I'm a businesswoman and I knew that the only way you can win this battle is to create a competitive model to Planned Parenthood, get women out of Planned Parenthood and into pro-life, comprehensive women's healthcare clinics so she'd never have to darken the door for her healthcare to at a Planned Parenthood or an abortion clinic.
Yeah, that's that's unbelievable. And what do you guys, what is it that you, because I love the whole compassionate and comprehensive thing. I mean, and what you don't perform is abortions in your clinic, but you try to educate and love and just and just talk to the person and guide them because they know they're at an alternative place.
Yes.
And they have chosen it for one reason or the other.
Stumbled on it.
Yeah. If somebody said something or texted them or whatever it is and they end up with your beautiful staff and your people that actually care.
Yes.
And it's, so, I mean, go through the difference, and this could be you know, pretty graphic of what you went through.
Graphic.
And all the, you know, the mattresses in the back and the screaming women and what, you know, you did then and what now is called Obria, what you guys, what you do now.
Right. Well, you know, it was, I look back on my career. So, by the way, too, when I came back to California, I decided to start my own company.
Okay.
So I did, and I ran that for 20 years, and it was in the biomedical device field, and I was a consultant and contractor for big medical device manufacturers. So it was was successful. I started in my living room. I grew it.
Always the entrepreneur.
Always the entrepreneur. And on the side, by the way, there was a break. When I came back from Oklahoma, I felt like I had really did what I told God I was going to do. Right. I was going to care for women. I done it for 4 years. Now I'm back in California, the old California.
Yeah, and I was like done. Oklahoma and California, a little different.
And so I was at this point saying, I'm going to start my company. It's going to take a lot of work. I'm going to work it in my house. I was even doing daycare for two other. By that time, I got pregnant again and then my third son. So by that time I had three boys. And I had one son before the abortion, and then I had two more. And my company was growing, and I was active in my church, and so were my children. And I really felt like I was getting in the groove.
Yeah, in the right direction anyway,
The sad part that the man that I married that I didn't know was very abusive.
Okay.
And, you know,
so he didn't come back with you to California, or he did?
He did.
Okay, so you both came back.
Yeah, well, we separated.
Okay.
And then he came back. I was going to stay in Oklahoma. He came and got me, and I just, you know, I was pregnant. I mean, I just had my middle son was 6 weeks old. When I came back to California, he was staying with me. I got pregnant again with my youngest. Right. And so I felt at this point, you know, he became a stay-at-home dad, and I started my company and ran the pregnancy center. And so we were doing okay.
Yeah.
Business was taking on, and then it did. And but
yet so another but.
So we came back, and I got involved in our church, and I went to this women's retreat Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday. And on Sunday night, he picked me up, brought me back home, and there was these boxes on the front porch. And I said to him, what are you, moving out? You know, I mean, this was the days when I would hide in the bushes and get into a hotel with nothing. And then I'd go back home because I had nowhere else to go. And And he was good for a while and so on and so forth. So I said, well, what are you moving on? He goes, I don't know what those are. But there was a white envelope. And I opened up the white envelope. It says, Kathleen. And it was the woman that was running the pregnancy center that I was helping raising money for. I was not working at the center. I was running my company. And said, Kathleen, I can't do it anymore. I put the 501c3 corporate papers in your name. I put the bank account in your name. There's $34 in the bank. The rent's due. I put the lease, you know, the rental lease in your name. Here's all the files that were birth choice. And good luck. I'm moving to St. Louis. Oh, and I disconnected the phone and blah, blah, blah.
Thank you.
So I was so angry. And the theme of the retreat was sometimes God doesn't give you an option. Swear. It's like when he calls, you know. Yeah. And I'm like, oh my gosh. So I threw him in the closet. That was on Sunday night. Monday morning, I had my two babies. Two more that I was babysitting. I'm exhausted. You know, women, we go to retreat, we talk a lot. Yeah. And so I'm feeding them and the phone rings. It's about 9 o'clock. And this woman is screaming in the phone. You've got to help. I mean, she was screaming. I'm not going to scream, but you've got to help. My best friend is sending her 16-year-old daughter to Kansas to have a late-term abortion. She's 6 months pregnant. She's carrying a little girl. And that was Dr. Tiller's abortion clinic, by the way, who was later killed. Anyway, and I said, I'm sorry, ma'am. I don't know why. Stop screaming. And then finally I said, how did you get this number? Or what number did you call? Yeah. And she gave me the number of the pregnancy center. And I realized that... Sue did not disconnect the phone. She forwarded it to my home. And it was that call that got me back in this movement.
Really locked it in.
Yeah. That night I called people at the church. I said, we need to pray. So I went to the church that evening, expected there'd be a handful of people. The church was packed.
Wow.
It was a small church. And it was packed and we prayed. We named that little baby Mary and that child. And I never spoke to that young girl, and I never spoke to that mother, and I never met that child, but God will show them one day that prayer,
what God stepped in.
What happened, and here we are today. I took those pregnancy centers medical and looked at the Planned Parenthood model. I closed my for-profit about 15 years later, and came full-time over into the ministry, and knew that if we were really going to make a difference and serve women and save babies from the atrocity of abortion, I needed to go over there full-time. And so then I realized I had to create a business model that a woman won't have to go into a Planned Parenthood like I did, and somebody will sit and talk to her and teach her and educate her on all three of her options. Because two of them are life.
Yep.
Parenting, adoption, and abortion. Two of them are life.
Yep.
Being given to young women around the world in the pro-life movement, and just loving on them and telling them you have an option, you have a choice, and it doesn't have to be this one.
Can you explain what it would be like if I opened the door and walked into a place? Just tell me what it would it be like if...
A place like home. In other words, we wanted it to be a place, a safe place for a woman, like she feels when she goes into her home. Hopefully, not always, but...
Yeah.
So it was a safe place, and we wanted her to feel like she's coming home.
Mm.
She's coming home, and in our heart, she's coming home to life. She's coming home to Christ.
Yes.
She's coming home to get off the slippery slope that she's been going down and change her life. So what that means is the pro-life movement is reactive.
Mm.
We wait for them to get in an unplanned pregnancy, and then we show them an ultrasound. Nowhere in the country had anybody built a model that was proactive, going upstream and meeting those women where they're at. It's a proactive model. I want a name that doesn't mean anything so I could trademark it. And we'll define it. And I always tell people back when we went to Obria, there was another company just emerging, and it was called Uber.
Yes.
What does Uber mean?
Yes. Yeah.
So it was a great, great thing for me, because I would go to these lovely donors that love birth choice because it was birth and it was choice. And what is Obria? And I'd say nothing. And I said, but
Neither was Uber.
I said, do you know this company called Uber? Well, of course. And I said, 5 years ago, you didn't know it.
You didn't know that word.
And 5 years from now, you're going to know Obria because we're going to define it as a safe place, a place that women feel like they can come home to no matter what they've done in their past. Yeah. In our space, they will be loved. They will be taught forgiveness. Mm-hmm. They will be nurtured. They will be hugged if they want it, you know. Yeah. And when we went to that model, I realized then doing so, we have to be a competitive model. And that's when we started comprehensive care, full women's comprehensive care. And to really compete. We do more services than Planned Parenthood. Yeah. Planned Parenthood is no prenatal care.
So they don't have to be pregnant even. So they can come in and do other women things that I don't know what they are.
But well, it's proactive means we want to get them off that slippery slope before they get into an unplanned pregnancy. So therefore, where we are today, we got a federal grant, a couple of federal grants.
Praise God, amazing.
And we got a Title V grant to take sexual risk avoidance education, sort of the new word of abstinence, into the public schools in California. Of course, we're fighting the California Healthy Youth Act.
Yeah.
And we're going to fight it. And we've been challenged by Planned Parenthood and the ACLU. They will sue us. But you know what? I've already been sued.
My guess is the lawsuits will never stop coming.
And that's where we're at today. Yeah. Bring it on, since we've gotten all these federal grants.
Oh, so you got the grants.
Yes.
Okay, so you, in one respect, you're one of the only competitive things to, or the alternative things to Planned Parenthood. You're pretty small a little while ago.
Yes.
Right? Then you start to go national. You get these grants. What in the world is the media doing now? When you must be, are you just under relentless attack? I mean, no one's saying, what a hero.
You know,
not on the left anyway.
No, I mean, I could say this, just Google Kathleen Bravo.
I'm scared to. I only want to look at your Obria page.
Yeah. Or Google Obria, Obria Medical Clinics. Yeah. You'd get an idea. It just goes on and on and on and on and on from, the New York Times to the Washington Post to Politico to Jezebel to ones I'd never heard of.
Well, all the loser publications.
Yes, the loser. Yeah. And I am the most evil.
Evil to save a life. Evil to help a woman.
And we've also, I'm one of those women too, coming from, learning everything you can on a woman's body.
Yep.
And that's how I've changed it, to understand and teach them how beautifully they're made.
Yes.
By the way, there's right now somewhere between 30 and 40%. I'm assuming it's 40%. It was 30% in 2017. Okay. That millennial women are going off of hormonal contraception because of it's a carcinogen and it occludes their body and they want to save the world.
Right.
And it's been such an interesting thing because Planned Parenthood's big service, of course, is abortion and hormonal contraception, making sure that eventually, because she's going to, this protects her to continue down that slippery slope, that but eventually she get pregnant and then they'll come back to us and we'll have an abortion. That's sort of their model. It's just this circle.
Whatever I can do to destroy all of you.
So we broke it and said, we don't do hormonal contraception and IUDs. We don't destroy a pregnancy as early as in the womb.
Right.
We rejoice, we bless it. We're blessed about it. So what we do is we're now embracing fertility education, fertility apps. 40% of millennials have gone on fertility apps, gone off hormonal contraception. And God is just answering so many issues. Yep. And so what happens to a woman when she's studying an app and sees how her body is made and how this beautiful process that God has created in women.
Yes.
And now they understand it. Yep. And guess what they do? They want to protect it.
They make decisions to protect it.
High school girls, 30 to 40% of high school girls now are saying they're not having sex in high school. Now, we'll take every nudge we can get.
Sure, yeah, absolutely.
So we moved even further to a holistic care clinics that is not anything in the old school, but bringing them into this new respecting your body, respecting your fertility, protecting your fertility, talking to them about what are your dreams in life. Well, they will, no matter what we hear, they want to meet the right guy, want to go to college, meet the right guy, get married, have children. And we said, well, if you keep going down this slippery slope of sex, drugs, and rock and roll,
you're going to crash sex, drugs,
every kind
and
of sex you can imagine. Yeah. The sad thing is we talked about the California Healthy Youth Act, and the program there is being taught by Planned Parenthood, written by the LGBTQ, and being enforced by the ACLU in California. and it is full pornographic.
Full onslaught, yeah.
Oh,
is that the
gosh.
triple X thing that I'm hearing about?
Yeah, it's I don't even know what the name of it is, but it's the program that's being taught. But praise God. And I'm putting a shout out to all those people listening that are parents and grandparents of children in California had enough. They saw the curriculum. They've seen the videos of
it's the showing it to kindergartners it and six-year-olds.
Right now we're at fourth grade, it's oral sex, it's anal sex. Men and men, women, women. It doesn't matter. It's all inclusive. It's
no right and wrong, nothing.
Gender equality. There's no right and
no
wrong.
Moral standard.
And finally, school districts are now, the parents are storming the school boards and the teachers don't want to teach it. And guess what? So we've end up getting two grants from President Trump.
Yes.
One is Title V Abstinence Education in California and Washington. And the other one is Teen Pregnancy Prevention, which is more of a research arm, but also instructing young people about their bodies, about sex, and protecting their fertility, protecting their health.
Yes.
I mean, look at the increase in
STDs
too,
STDs
that we thought were going. Suicides. Yep. Number one killer of teens is suicide.
I know.
Huge.
Something the left is doing is not working.
Syphilis.
Something that
it's
they're trying to
working.
You know, fire hose them with crap is not actually working unless their goal is to kill people.
And that's where we are. So you see, I just have to say this. I look back and I laugh because I see God moving. It's sort of I watched a cog go into his plan. You know, we end up with the most pro-life president ever in the world. We end up with Supreme Court justices that are pro-life. Yep. We end up with Obria going national. Now we're in seven or eight states. We have 48 clinics growing. I just got a call from New York City. Pray for us.
New York City.
Four clinics in New York City.
Yes.
Chicago, Minneapolis. I mean, it is just growing.
It's growing.
And what that cog, that last one was, a pro-life president, a pro-life house and, Senate. Pro-life Supreme Court. Maybe we'll get the house. We have a group that's gone national, a national brand. Obria is now known. President Trump and Vice President Pence get our white paper describing where the pro-life movement was, where it is, where it needs to go. They're blown away. They call. Next thing you know, I get a grant. I thought we were just really special, but actually, because we were national and a grant. And here we are. So we got Title 10 was taken away from Planned Parenthood. They turned it back because of
Trump's... Seemingly impossible. The Roe we were headed down. It just seemed like there's no way that's going
to happen. First time in 50 years, a pro-life, faith-based organization got Title X funding. Now, people say, well, don't take federal money. You know, it's federal money to pay for services. It does take it away from the fact that we can preach. We just can't use that money to do our beginnings and our parenting and our post-abortive healing. It is money to
expand
our brand.
Which is weird that you can't preach because they're preaching. Everyone's preaching. It's just ridiculous.
Of course. We can preach. We just can't spend that money.
Right.
Anyway, to make a long story short, we got Title X. Next thing we know, the California Healthy Youth Act comes. We get Title V and TPP, Teen Pregnancy Prevention. Yep. And we train everybody in sexual risk avoidance education. It's avoiding sex, protecting your body, empowering their mind, body, and spirit to become who they can be. And all of a sudden, Obria is going nose to nose with Planned Parenthood. And Planned Parenthood comes after us. And Trump said, okay, Planned Parenthood, you want Title X, you got to move your abortions out of that facility. If you're well woman care, you cannot do abortions there. And therefore, Planned Parenthood said, we don't want the money. And they blamed me. And
Good for you.
I blame
you too.
Group.
Thank you.
Yes.
Thank you, by the way.
I'm going to put a challenge to everybody who's listening.
Yes.
That Trump said, and HHS said, you know, Trump fought this battle for the Protect Life rule in Title X so that Christian organizations like Obria can step into the fight and get that funding. And nobody else did, nobody did but me. It's all right. I'll carry the load. Yep. I've been beat up. My head's been chopped off. You know, it's okay. But I'm praying that next year when the next cycle comes out, I want to see every pro-life group and faith-based organization.
Writing those grants, getting those
papers. It is phenomenal. And
it's only fair. I mean, why not have alternatives? I would think that's the whole point of the democracy. It's like, okay, they can do that, I guess, but we should have equal pay. funding on the other side. Well, and, mm-hmm. let the public decide
right.
what they want to do, and let them be properly educated so they can choose and not be tricked or marketed to. Mm-hmm. But just here's the real information.
Absolutely.
And then you choose. It's still your choice, right? But we
say that again because that's so important.
It really is, right? Because and the left is incredibly tricky. Satan, I would say, is really tricky with words. You know, pro-choice. When do you ever have a choice to kill someone else? But they put it into the mm-hmm. the body, and then they come up with all kinds of terms that lure you to the other way. Which is why they probably mm-hmm. don't ever show ultrasounds, because I hear that if a woman sees an ultrasound with a baby, she's like 80% more likely to not have an abortion. Why don't they want to let her know? See, there's a trick that's deep trickery.
It is. And if you think about it, even abortion, they call it reproductive health.
Yeah, exactly. That's the other thing.
You don't health. Even, we want, we need that money for reproductive health. Reproductive.
It's not healthy.
That's abortion.
Yeah, of course
that's
it is.
Their words now. They're not saying the word anymore. It's
because,
abortion.
Because if we're really honest, you don't grow up when you're a five-year-old girl and want to be a princess. You don't go, I can't wait to have sex and abort my kid. Mm-hmm. And no one thinks that.
Right.
So you have to be in a bad state and be lured somewhere to get there.
Absolutely.
Right? Things have to happen to you like they did to you and lots of all these other ladies. They feel like they're trapped. And then the guy's ringing the bell. I'll take care of you with reproductive health.
Yes.
Oh, that's healthy.
Yes.
And then they go in.
I'll put the money out because, we don't want to have a child. That wasn't in the deal here. It was purely sex.
Yeah.
You should have taken care of it. And there is a lot of now big federal grants, Christian grants that are switching over to three issues because they believe that it's these three issues that are destroying our nation.
Absolutely.
And that is abortion, human trafficking, and pornography.
Yeah.
And I've been part of the human trafficking task force here in California, and we work with them around the country because those girls, of course, we want them to come into our clinics and be tested and loved on. Pornography, we all know the statistics are girls and boys. Everybody thinks it's young men. It is not.
It's like 30-40% of the girls. I know.
30-40% of young women. And then, of course, abortion.
Yep.
And so we have a fight in front of us, but
well,
these are so
together,
linked.
Right?
Yes.
You see how it's all working together. You have these pervert, weird guys putting pictures on because they know it's all on the phone.
Mm-hmm.
So the person gets the phone. He's a 15-year-old boy. He sees it. He gets his mind starts getting messed up. He sees a girl, sees her as an object, has sex with her because she's doing the same thing. And then, of course, now they want to have an abortion.
Mm-hmm.
And then if the one is cast aside and her parents don't want her, she runs away and she's in human trafficking.
Absolutely.
Inside the whole thing. It's a vicious circle, and you can see how it all works together.
I know. It's sometimes I think, okay, God, I just can't do this anymore. But the one thing I do is, because I was a businesswoman, I started this little company, as I shared, a for-profit in my home, and I went up against some of the largest advertising and marketing companies.
Yeah.
Ended up in the biomedical field, they market all of their new devices and so on and so forth. And all the instruction sheets, everything that has to be done. And that's where God put me. Funny thing
is,
I would go in, say, for example, one of these big companies, they would buy out other medical device. Mm-hmm. And then I would go in and I would change them to the brand of their new.
Right.
And I think to myself, okay, God, I'm in biomedical. I understand clinical trials. I'm in the clean rooms. I'm doing R&D with medical device.
Yep.
And so I've got this medical background because everybody says, are you a doctor or a nurse?
Yeah.
I said, no.
No, I just know everything about all the
And then
equipment.
I start become their rebranding person. And my company goes in and, these everything from their instruction sheets and their marketing and advertising, their chipboard boxes, all has to be rebranded. Fast forward, God brings me into the pro-life movement because of my abortion.
Yes.
And by the way, I've named my son Toby.
Okay.
And so because of my son Toby, he's waiting for me in heaven. And I'm thinking to myself, well, nothing I did is what's going to fit here. And every bit of it fit.
Yeah.
The medical side, understanding the medical field in the marketing side. And branding. We now have rebranded all of these clinics from old names.
It's
so God.
So
it's just sometimes we think God isn't using us, even when we're broken.
Yeah,
God's using us.
Oh, that's probably when
He
uses
doesn't
us the
turn
most,
His back
I think,
on us.
Is
yeah,
when we are broken and weak.
Yes.
So,
where do we go from here?
Like that's my question. You said where are we going? What is the next level? What is it that? Here's a good way to put it. What is it that Christians, the churches, because, it's so politicized now.
Yes.
And we have signs up that don't work, and we're yelling. Both sides are yelling at each other. it's foolish to me. Mm-hmm. But what is it that, from your insight, that we can do to enter these conversations and to really mm-hmm. change this into not a movement, but this is normal. And Planned Parenthood yes. is the thing off to the side.
So I sort of shared about the fact that, you know, God has put every piece mm-hmm. in place for such a time as this. And that is our theme. Right. In everything we do yeah. now is for such a time yeah. as this. God brought it all to a place and we were ready. I mean, as I shared years ago when someone suggested to go national, take what you've developed here in California, Kathleen, it needs to go national. And I said, no. And I told God, no, the pro-life movement, we have a tendency not to work closely with each other.
Right.
We're very territorial, yep. which is really, really sad. And I thought, you know, I'm going to be beat up by Planned Parenthood and I'm really not going to be liked yep. by pro-life if I sort of raise my head up. Yeah. It's kind of whack-a-mole,
yeah.
you know?
Yeah.
And so I said, no, until I said, God, show me a big yeah. audacious wow that it's you and I'll do it. And he threw me up against the wall and said, okay, here you go. And I got a $2.5 million donation. And now if that's not...
It's a loudspeaker. That's a loudspeaker.
So we formed that Vision Strategy Committee and moved forward. So what I have done is I watch Planned Parenthood and we look at what they're doing. Mm-hmm. I get their year-end, you can download it yep. online, their year-end report. Right. I look at where their money's going, what they're doing. And guess what came out in 2015? In 2015, Planned Parenthood developed something called a telemedicine app.
Right.
I'm thinking, what the heck is that? Yep. And of course, realized that that the Obamacare originally came out. It was really for people like me. Instead of going and waiting for your blood pressure, I mean, I'm not on any of yep. that, thank God. But yep. you just go and you online and you connect to this app, yep. and a nurse comes up and she does, you know, questions and yep. vitals, and then okay, she calls you a prescription yep. from your home. Well, guess who jumped on that? Planned Parenthood. Could you imagine if they could reach those women on an app right where they're at, yep. in their safe place? In that bedroom in their home.
In the privacy of
And what else came just before that? RU 46.
Yeah.
Now, please understand, RU 46 is not the morning after pill. Or, it is an abortion pill. 86 illegal sites are dispensing it in this country, according to the Charlotte Lozier Institute. Planned Parenthood has jumped on board. They created their own telemedicine app called Planned Parenthood Direct. Girl gets on there 24/7. Nurse comes up. She says, you know, I just missed my period. I'm 5 months. Mm-hmm. The nurse, they ask her questions. They said, okay, no problem. We're going to dispense the pill. Right now, half of the states in this country use telemedicine to dispense the RU46 pill. So that girl goes home to her safe place, to her bedroom, takes that pill. 72 hours later, takes another set of pills and aborts that baby in her bathroom and flushes it down the toilet. Right now, in some states like Iowa, 74% of first trimester abortions are being done by the pill. Nationally, it's hitting 50%. Actually, Reuters in 2017 said the abortion pill is going nose to nose against surgical abortion. Planned Parenthood jumped on it. They have three apps now. They have Planned Parenthood Direct, where they get a nurse and they dispense the pill. They have Planned Parenthood Care, which girl can call in and get her STD testing in a box. It comes to her house. She goes back in. You see what's happening.
Yes.
Not only are young people everything, they have their relationship skills are gone because everything they do is on their computer or their iPhone. Planned Parenthood has become that face on that iPhone. And then their third one is fertility app. Now you wonder why, because the fertility app came out of the pro-life movement. Mm-hmm. Well, because they did, too, realize that 40% of millennials, and it's going to grow, are moving away from hormonal contraception. And sure enough, in 2017, their year-end report, they had a 30% drop in their contraceptive money.
Sure.
So they built fertility and said, we still want to keep them because we'll teach them our fertility app. And eventually that cycle, just like on hormonal contraception, will end up pregnant and they'll come yep. to us for abortion. This is the cycle we need to
what
break.
What is the, yeah, which is?
Online. And guess what? In 2017, Obria launched Obria Direct, the only pro-life telemedicine app in the country where a girl can download the app, talk to a pro-life nurse, get her off that slippery slope, get her into our, yes, we're not going to dispense pills.
Sure.
And but what we're going to do is, people say, well, you're not really meeting what she's looking for. And she says, you know, you all think she really is looking for an answer, but the answer is not always pills
she's
and drugs and abortion. She's looking for somebody to say, you're okay. Yeah. If we're not on that app, so our digital marketing.
So that's got to be a huge step for you guys.
In fact, we're going to finish out this year with development. And in January, our whole focus is going to be another app. We want a fertility app. Yep. They're expensive, but we're going to do it. We created this one, $2 million. Yep. Young Christian, developers. Expensive. Oh, yeah. No, we did it for $2 million. Yeah. Theirs was $22 million, Planned Parenthood. But we did the same. But we get Christian developers, these young guys.
Yep.
So bottom line is today, now you can see where the pregnancy resource centers with the ultrasound and the diapers and formula are wonderful. And they're a point out there. But young women, every one of them are talking.
Yep.
They're not walking in. And we're kind of playing games with it in our movement instead of realizing like, okay, let's just have this really sort of come to Jesus
moment. Just everybody
moment
work together and get it done.
And say, we got to get on, we're only going to meet them. And it's going to grow. Today, 97%. Think about this. 97% of first trimester abortions in Europe are done by the pill. 97%. We will be there. I believe we'll be there by 2022, if not not earlier.
If you guys don't get the funding and all the other people don't step up and man up and get
in the
game,
then we're going to fall behind and there's nothing we can do. 86% of millennial women say, 86%, I want my healthcare online. Yep. I want that first point of contact.
Yep.
And if the pro-life movement is not there, they've won. And that's what Planned Parenthood was banking on. That's what the abortion pill, people selling them, these websites coming from Europe, 86 of them controlling this movement of the abortion pill. If we're not there, we might as well pack up and go home.
Oh, I agree. I always thought through this thing. I just don't get the motive of the other side. It just must
be
money.
Money.
That's the only thing I can think of. There's a power in money because who really wants this?
And they
wants to lead people to kill their babies and just rock
money.
On and make their money.
And they make more money from the pill.
Oh, I'm sure.
Than they do from a surgical abortion.
Sure, I'm sure they're going to make trillions of dollars off
absolutely.
This horrible, horrible
thing. And that's where we are today.
Yeah.
And thank God. So that last cog was Obria Direct. It's an app. Download it. Share it.
Yes.
Everybody share it with young women
to
know.
Donate. Build,
right. Yeah. And there's great fertility apps out there. And between the fertility apps that moves them beyond this hormonal contraceptive and polluting your bodies, but into protecting your fertility to have babies in the future, but also an app where a nurse can talk to her. Look, we have an app that we can put up 24/7. The problem is you got to staff
it. People.
And
people
we don't
have
the funds.
Right.
So we're doing it during the day when the clinics are open, but every little bit that comes in, then we get one more of our 48 clinics will be up on telemedicine in 7 states. Hopefully, our goal is 200 brick and mortar clinics attached to a telemedicine site, driving them to any place in the state. I can drop my telemedicine app in any zip code anywhere in this country right now.
Amazing. You have been a protector of your mom in a way. You've been a protector of your kids.
Mm-hmm.
Now you're protecting women and the unborn.
Yes.
You're a true blessing and a true warrior. We do one thing that we call the one thing in 1 minute.
Yes.
So you look at that camera and from the heart, you go, here's the one thing in 1 minute.
Here is the one thing in 1 minute. First of all, pray. We are going into the schools here in California and Washington to challenge in California the California Healthy Youth Act. We know we will be sued by the ACLU and we'll be attacked by Planned Parenthood. And we're okay with that. We are warriors. Today, every one of my staff people, every one of my nurses and doctors are warriors in this fight. So we are going to take on the public schools in California and Washington. We're going to continue to grow our national brand of Obria, comprehensive women's healthcare clinics that does everything from, STD testing and treatment, well woman care, pap smears, blood draws, cancer screenings, prenatal care up to delivery. We're going to continue to grow that model for Christ. So if you're a warrior, and I pray to God every one of you are, because isn't that what God has called us to do? Is to be disciples of today. And in today's culture, that means you're going to be hated, you're going to be attacked, you're going to be maligned, but just keep on walking. I get up every day, I put on the armor of Christ, I do not turn, it's the breastplate, it's not back, I can't turn and retreat. I'm asking you to march with us. Obria Medical Clinics need your help. All of what we're doing takes funding, all of what we're doing takes prayer, takes volunteers, And if you have a little bit that you can spare, send it to us. If you have time you can spare, come and be with us. If you are a medical professional and want to work and get paid, we paid well, in a pro-life organization, we need medical assistants, nurses, nurse practitioners, and pro-life doctors. So I can't do it alone. God's with me. God's with you. I promise that I will do this until God takes me home. I will continue to serve women and young men and to save women and babies and all the family members that will lose so that no woman and no child will ever be destroyed by the atrocity of abortion. So God bless you.
Yeah, well said. Make sure you go to obria.com.
Is it obria.com? obria.org.
And hit the donate button.
Yes.
Such a special time with you. Thank you so much. We'll see you guys next time on the Bub and Bob Show. Later.
Bye.
Wow.